Today, what we are doing, though, is wrapping up our kind of little four-week series post-Easter time called Follow Me, Practicing the Way of Jesus. For us, it is our annual primer on what it actually means to follow Jesus. And I know there's a lot of different stories in the room. For some of you guys, you're hearing this for the first time, either from us or in general. And it's sort of like maybe breaking some paradigms about what being a Christian actually means. For others of you, you've heard this from me or from someone else multiple times. And instead of it being redundant, that is reinforcing a core fundamental of what it means to follow Jesus. And so we started in on this series a couple of weeks ago, and we started from this often overlooked, and I believe really profound moment from the book of John, which we've been in the book of John for about a year. We preached John 20 on Easter Sunday. But if what's interesting about John is the resurrection is not the end of the story for John. There's like a little epilogue. There's John 20. There's a whole lot of ways the resurrected Jesus is encountering people in all sorts of different emotional states and physical states and spiritual states. And so we worked through that around Easter time. But even after that, there's still more to the story. John 21 is this interesting little epilogue or add-on or whatever. And what we have here is this, it feels like a really human moment, sort of like a life going back to normal moment. We have this momentous like crucifixion, resurrection, earth-shattering, world-shaking moments, and the resurrected Jesus is encountering people. And then we sort of flash to John 21, where his disciples are back on the boat fishing again. They're going back to their day jobs and just kind of going through normal life. And the resurrected Jesus encounters them again and particularly has these lengthy conversations with Peter on the beach. And he's doing two things with Peter. He's restoring a broken Peter after we remember his thrice denials right before Jesus is crucified, of following him, of knowing who Jesus is. And in this beautiful, sweet, somber, healing moment, Jesus is building Peter back up. But then we also see Jesus correcting kind of a weird rumor that's been circulating among the disciples that John would live forever. As a side note, did you guys know there are still people who believe that John is still alive? Like John the beloved? Like it's not only just a weird rumor then, it's like a thing people still believe and buy into today that John would live forever until Jesus like returns again. And what Jesus is doing with Peter is he brings this kind of weird theological rumor that is out there. He brings some correction to Peter, and he says, like, don't get so worried about this weird rumor that's going around. What should you concern yourself with? Yeah, me. You follow me. Like, don't worry about that other stuff. You follow me. And in these two verses in John chapter 21, verses 19 and then 20 and 22, Jesus ends both of these kind of conversational moments with the same command. Verse 19, after saying this to him, which is the feed my sheep, tend my sheep, all of that, he says, follow me. And then in verses 21 and 22, when Peter saw him and he said, Jesus, Lord, what about this man? Pointing to John, Jesus said to him, if it is my will that he remain until I come, what is that to you? You follow me. The identical command in two very different situations. Restoration and distraction, right? Restoration after Peter's three denials in those tender healing moments, and distraction, right? And one of his parables, Jesus talks about distractions, the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches. And it's kind of the same idea here, that Peter is on some weird theological debate that is clearly not very important to Jesus. And Jesus says, what is that to you? You follow me. Now for us, as we've been working through this text over the last couple of weeks, whether you are in need of healing and restoration and soul care, or whether you're getting distracted with things that don't matter, the call from Jesus is the same. Follow me. And so that's where we've been camping out, is what does it actually mean to follow Jesus? What does it look like? What does following Jesus look like, particularly in the chaos and confusion of our modern digital distracted world that you and I live in? And we as a church, years ago, have landed on this very simple but profound framework that we kind of filter every discipleship conversation through. And that is to apprentice Jesus, to be a disciple of Jesus, to follow after him. We love the word apprentice for all the layers and weight that it carries. But to apprentice Jesus is to orient your life around three goals. What's the first one? You don't have to think of it, it's on the screen behind me. Be with Jesus. There you go. And that's the simple framework that Jesus himself used, exemplared, replicated, and have given to us as we follow him still today. To be with Jesus, the first and most important goal, to spend our time with him. This is the baseline for any who would follow Jesus. It would be silly to follow Jesus and never actually spend time with Jesus. We like to say often the best part of following Jesus is what? Jesus. Is that we get him. He's our treasure, that we get to be with him and be close to him. That we have access to him, that we can approach the throne of grace. This is one of the great demarcations of Christianity with just about any other world religion, is proximity to Jesus. But it doesn't stop there. As we are near to him and with him, we inevitably become like him. Out of that place of abiding with him, the goal was to become more like him. So depending on your spiritual heritage, this might have been sanctification, spiritual formation, or just maturity or growth. Like whatever word you maybe are used to is the same word. We are becoming more like Jesus, growing into his Christ-likeness, into his image. And then finally, though, it doesn't start with kind of the internals of just being with him and being transformed, but it actually spills out into our everyday lives where we do the things that he would do. And the goal is that not that you would know a lot about Jesus, just intellectual knowledge or the Bible, although that's great stuff. The goal is that you and me would become the kind of people that are actually with him, becoming like him. And because of that, we are going on about the same things that Jesus was on about. We are joining him in his work here and now in Ventura. And we are making the same kind of decisions Jesus would make if he were us, our person, our personality, our stage of life. And the basic idea with this kind of threefold apprenticeship to Jesus matrix is that following Jesus isn't this sort of intellectual checklist thing. Like, do you believe the right information? Yes, you go to heaven. No, you go to hell. Story over. That's not at all what Jesus or the writers of the Bible had in mind. So we take on this posture of apprentice, learner, student, disciple, and our whole life is oriented around being with him, becoming like him, and doing what he did. And we know this is a lifelong journey and a lifelong goal. But here's the deal. That's kind of all, in summary, where we've been the last couple weeks. If we're being honest, and maybe this is just, maybe I'm speaking for myself, and maybe I'm speaking for others in the room as well. If we're being honest, we can kind of wrap our head around being with Jesus. That kind of makes sense to us, especially if you've grown up in a church tradition. And maybe we can take a step further and we can wrap our head around becoming like him. Yeah, we're supposed to be a better person, a more moral person, a person who lives the values of the Bible or whatever. We can maybe wrap our head around that. But the idea of joining him in his work, of, dare I say, doing what he actually did, may confound some frameworks and worldviews that you might have. I know it certainly did for me years ago when we have been on this journey as a church together. Because how do we actually do that? Wasn't he God? We're not God. We can't do what he did because we're not God. And it's a weird place to find ourselves. Like, how do we actually do this? But if we remember back to Jesus' framework for his own discipleship, part of following him was actually becoming like him. Like, if we just think about an apprentice in general, the whole idea of an apprenticeship is that one day you become, whatever, a master electrician or a plumber, I don't know, a licensed plumber, or you become a photographer in your own right or a graphic designer in your own right. The goal of any apprenticeship is that you would eventually get to the point where you're doing some of the things that the person apprenticed you was doing. So, today, I want to unpack three key ideas. First idea is, to do what Jesus did, we must move from being a passive spectator to a committed participant. Second key idea, to do what Jesus did, we actually have to do what Jesus did. Third key idea is that we can do what Jesus did because God has made it possible. Three key ideas. So if you get nothing else from today, this is what we are trying to unpack together as a community. First key idea, to do what Jesus did, we must move from being a passive spectator to committed participant. Cue my biannual rant against consumer Christianity right here. Because this is really what it is. Like, consumer Christianity causes us to, like, immediately hit the eject button when we talk about doing what Jesus did. Because it's not comfortable, it's not easy, it's not familiar, it's not known. And it somehow breaks this idea that I can show up, get something like a good or service, and then leave and not actually be asked of anything. Last week, we talked about this idea that so many of us feel the disconnect between the promise of change in our life and our actual reality. Because often we believe information alone will change us. Like, information does not change us. And so doing what Jesus did is actually stepping out into these moments of practice and not just letting stories about Jesus reside in our mind, but actually flow through our hands and our feet. Jesus, at the very end of the Sermon on the Mount, one of his most famous sermons in Matthew chapter 7, says this: "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven. Not everyone who shows up at church on Sunday will enter the kingdom of heaven. Not everyone who is given money, tithes, and offerings to a church will enter the kingdom of heaven. But the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven, on that day many will say to me, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, cast out demons in your name, and do mighty works in your name?' And then I will declare to them, 'I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness.'" There's a pastor and writer in Melbourne, Australia, Mark Sayers, who just has a phenomenal new book out I'm very excited about. And a couple of books ago, he developed this idea of PACT, P-A-C-T. And it was short for passive-aggressive consumer trap. And he says, his argument is that this is the dominant way Christians in the West have approached all of life, including God, church, but also our jobs, our friendships, our houses, our neighborhoods, all of that. And what he means by this idea of passive-aggressive consumer trap is that we live in a culture that prizes critique, that prizes image, that prizes looking like we're onto something, but still staying removed and distant and staying disengaged. So we can see this play out in the last couple of years of social media activism. We're like, people are posting stuff online. It's like, I know you're not at a rally marching with people. You're just like firing off like a really provocative tweet or something like that. Or you're just like reposting some image on Instagram to spread awareness. But you're not actually doing anything. You're staying removed and disengaged and maybe even disinterested. And this is the opposite of what it actually means to follow Jesus. That we are highly interested in receiving something of value, having lots of opinions, talking a big game, but not actually having any skin in the game, not actually doing anything different, is the trap that so many of us, the big you, us, have fallen into. And I know I can look at my own life and say, I've fallen into that trap so, so often. It is so much easier to critique and to give an opinion than it is to actually involve yourself. And we might be disengaged and disinterested for a number of reasons. But maybe the prime one, I think, that particularly my generation gets caught up with is maybe waiting for something better to come along. So we hold back ourselves in case there's another better option out there. I think we see this play out in like the app dating game right now, which is like, I'm so thankful I met Sherry right before like app dating was becoming a thing, because I would be so awful at like dating on an app. It sounds awful to me. I have so much sympathy and so much compassion for those who are single, they're trying to meet people. It is so difficult. But I think we get trapped into just swipe right, swipe left, reply to this person, not reply to this one, and not get too far in case someone comes along that is better. We treat the church like that. I don't know if I want to fully give myself to this people, because what if I find a better church? We do that with our jobs. We do that with a myriad of things in our lives. Because in our time and our place, we are oppressed by what we could be doing, not what we are actually doing. FOMO is a very real thing, fear of missing out. The idea that there could be something else that we could be participating in paralyzes us from actually any action here. Ventura is a really transient place, and I talk to a number of people who are maybe here for a season, then move on, and maybe they're single, and then they meet someone, and they move away, or maybe they are married, newly married here, but once they have kids, they want to move out of the downtown part of the city, or whatever. They want to buy a house, and they move to somewhere else that's affordable. Fill in the blank. You all know these stories. And these conversations, I feel like a broken record. I'm just having these on repeat all the time, and my conversations are the same. It's like, cool, you're going to be here for 6 months, you're just finishing this program, and then you're moving on. That's awesome. Like, we meet a lot of doctors and nurses who are doing that. I'm just doing my residency, I'm here for like 2 years, then I'm out, and probably moving somewhere else, et cetera, et cetera. And my encouragement to them is always, it's my summer encouragement to you that I just gave. It's like, hey, while you're here, be present, and if you're going somewhere in 6 months, cool. Let us deposit into you, you deposit into us, and we will joyfully send you on your way when God takes you to the next season of your life. But how often, and you may know friends, you may know family who are in this situation, I have a hate-hate relationship with motorcycles in downtown. How often have you had these conversations with people, even your friends and your family, who are just like, I don't really want to commit because I know I'm going to be gone somewhere else. I know I'm going to be gone in 6 months, so why bother? I don't want to actually fully plug in to this job because I know I'm only here for the short term or whatever. It just plays into this idea that we somehow have a permission structure that allows us to just sort of like lean back a little bit and not be asked of anything in life. So maybe we're waiting for something better, or we're not committing because we could be doing something different, or maybe we're disengaged because we're actually quite comfortable where we're at, and any change at all is uncomfortable. So I know there are different types of people in the room. For me, there's nothing more comforting than change. I like it. If something's staying the same, like I start to get a little twitchy, and I know for some of you that's like the polar opposite. And Lord bless you for being on this church journey with me, because we've been through so many changes as a church community. But for some of you, change of any kind is just deeply uncomfortable and unsettling. And any change at all can really throw you through a loop. But I would encourage you to not underestimate the power that comfort is as a roadblock as you're apprenticing Jesus, because he will inevitably call you into a life of taking up your cross, denying yourself, and calling you into the unknown and uncomfortable. In his book, The Road Trip That Changed the World, Sayers makes this case that we want to be a part of something bigger than ourselves. We just don't want to be bound by it. So we love the idea of a church community until we're asked to commit. We love the idea of this career where we're contributing to some greater good until it asks too much of us. We love the idea of following Jesus until we actually have to follow him. We love the idea of becoming like Jesus until it starts to cost us something. And still we have to lay down old habits and patterns. We love the idea of doing what Jesus did until we actually have to do what Jesus did. And we're like, I didn't sign up for this. Praying for healing? No. Preaching the gospel to somebody? No. Being hospitable to the stranger? I didn't sign up for any of this stuff. But the reality is, if we are actually going to be a people who follow Jesus, that's going to include being with him, becoming like him, and actually doing what he did. And to do that, we have to change our mindset. Renew, to use Paul's language in Romans 12, to renew our minds and move from being a consumer, a passive consumer, to a committed participant in the way of Jesus. So if we can fix that renewal, that kind of change in worldview, that pattern of thinking, then the second key idea is to do what Jesus did. We actually have to do what he did. We can't just talk about it and kind of rally around the idea that it's a good idea that we should do the things that we did. We should actually do those things in life. There's this moment in Jesus' life as he's working with his disciples that often gets Sunday schoolified. I don't know if that's a real word. I made that word up. I rant and rave about Jonah often, that it's been too like Sunday schoolified and we missed the point of Jonah. We'll get into that this summer. Don't you worry. But there's another moment that kind of gets Sunday schoolified and it misses the power. And it's in Matthew chapter 4. And starting in verse 18, while walking by the Sea of Galilee, Jesus saw two brothers, Simon, who's called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. He set the scene. Got a boat, you know, of some kind of size. The two brothers are in there. They're trying to rope in some fish. And Jesus said to them, what did he say? Follow me. There we go. And I will make you fishers of men. Pause. Now, we see that and we're like, oh, Jesus is so punny. They're fishermen, and instead of fishing for fish, I'm going to rope you in some men. You know, we're going to go out and try to gather a bunch of people and be fishers of men. And it actually kind of like misses what is happening here. This wasn't a cheesy Christian bumper sticker situation, but this was like Hebrew slang for I'll make you like me. I don't have time to get into the full backstory here, but this was like a first century Hebrew idiom for a great teacher, a fisher of men. And Jesus is basically saying in this moment, he's like, I'm going to make you a great teacher. I'm going to make you like me. Follow me and I'll make you like me. You'll do the things that I'm doing. And Peter and Andrew here, this is very appealing, because to not only follow a rabbi, but to be sort of commissioned by him was like the tops in Jewish life. And he says, hey, get off your boat, come follow me, and I will make you like me. Jesus is saying, these are the things that I am doing. If you follow me, you'll become like me. Immediately, verse 20, they left their nets and followed him. This was compelling. They didn't know Jesus from anybody. I don't know, maybe they saw him growing up at the synagogue or something. We don't really know much of the backstory. But whatever Jesus was saying was so compelling that they left their nets and followed him. They dropped everything. And going from there, he saw two other brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, in the boat with Zebedee, their father, mending their nets, and he called them. Immediately, they left the boat and their father and followed him. All right, so far, four people leaving their day jobs because of this simple phrase, I will make you fishers of men. And he went throughout all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every disease and every affliction among the people. So his fame spread throughout all Syria. And they brought him all the sick, those afflicted with various diseases and pains, those oppressed by demons, those having seizures and paralytics, and he healed them. Okay, so remember, what did Jesus say? Follow me and I'll make you fishers of men, which means I will make you like me. Okay, what was Jesus doing? He calls all these disciples. He went throughout all of Galilee. And what's happening here? What is Jesus doing? He's healing people. What else? Teaching. What's the big one? We're all scared to say it. Casting out demons. He's healing people. He's healing the sick. He's preaching the kingdom of God. He's casting out demons. His fame is spreading, and he's calling disciples saying, come follow me, and I will make you just like me. Notice how Jesus commissions his disciples in John chapter 13. For I've given you an example that you should also do just I have done to you. In John 14, truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes in me, which we know believe is not intellectual, right? Our time in John, belief is this whole life trust in Jesus. Whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do. Anyone scared yet? And greater works than these will he do, because I'm going to the Father. When he says I'm going to the Father, that means a couple of theological realities. One, he's at the right hand of God interceding on our behalf. But two, he sends his Spirit. So why in John 14 and 16 does Jesus say it's better that I go so you can get the Spirit? It's because Jesus incarnate was finite. He was fully God, but he was also fully man, which means he was one Jesus walking around the Middle East for a couple of years. As Jesus goes back to the Father and sends his Holy Spirit, you and I all now live with the very Spirit and presence of Jesus in me. Why can we do greater works than Jesus himself did? Well, because there's not one Jesus, there's like 2 billion Jesuses walking around. We have his Spirit in us. He gives us his Spirit, and now we can join him and participate in his mission here on earth. Paul picks up on this same idea too in two of his letters to churches, where he says, be imitators of me as I am of Christ. And he says to the Ephesians, be imitators of God as beloved children. And John picks up on this as well, the beloved apostle. Whoever says he abides in him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. And one author commentating on that verse says, if we want to live the life of Jesus, we must adopt the lifestyle of Jesus. So clearly, part of following Jesus, apprenticing him, is not just being with him and becoming like him, which can very quickly stay internal, but actually doing what he did. To use biblical language, imitating Jesus. Doing the works that Jesus did and greater works than Jesus did. This means healing the sick, praying for the lost, preaching the gospel, opening up our homes and lives to those who are far from God, and on and on and on. Look at this moment in the book of Mark, chapter 3. And Jesus went up on the mountain and called to him those whom he desired, and they came to him. And he appointed 12, whom he also named apostles, so that they might be with him, and he might send them out to preach and have authority to cast out demons. They may be with him, follow me. And he sent them out to do what? To cast out demons and to preach. What is Jesus known for? There you go. Three primary things Jesus is known for: teaching, preaching the kingdom of God, casting out demons, healing the sick. This is what Jesus had been doing. And at some point, Jesus says, all right, guys, you're ready. Get out of here. Go do likewise. And we see throughout the story of the four Gospels that there's some beautiful moments where he sends out some disciples, sometimes on their own, sometimes in pairs. And they come back and they're like, okay. Jesus is like, how did it go, guys? He's like a coach in this moment. How did it go, guys? We cast out this demon here, we healed this person here, but we got really stuck with this kind of demon. What do we do? He's like, you got to pray and fast for that. And then they go back out again, and they try again. This is beautiful apprentice moment where there Jesus is sending him back. They're coming back and they're debriefing, and he's sending him right back out again to do the things that he is doing. This is what it means to be a disciple of Jesus. The goal is that you would not know a lot about the Bible. The goal is that you would not pray a lot. The goal is that you would not show up at church every single Sunday. The goal is that you would, through being with him and becoming like him, actually be the kind of person who imitates Jesus in your person, personality, and stage of life. That you'd actually join him in the things that he is already doing here in Ventura through your friends, your coworkers, your neighbors, your family, your kids, whatever. Jesus is at work in all of those spaces and spheres, and the invitation is for you to join him in that work, imitating what he would do. So far, to do what Jesus did, we must move from passive spectator to committed participant, and we actually have to do the things that Jesus was doing. To step out and proclaim the gospel to those far from God, show hospitality, pray for the sick, cast out demons, all the things that Jesus was doing, we're invited to step into those same spaces. But the most critical theological reality we must understand is we cannot do these things because we are awesome on our own, but we can do what Jesus did because God has enabled us to do what Jesus did. And there's one key verse I want to take us to. That's Romans 8, verse 11. Paul's writing about life in the spirit in Romans chapter 8, as opposed to the old person, life in the flesh. And he says, if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, which we know this is a rhetorical if, Paul is very much saying, you have the Holy Spirit. He who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit who dwells in you. Okay, what do we know? We know from this verse that the spirit of the living God dwells in you, and it's the same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead. Do you think that same spirit can help us proclaim the gospel to those who are far from God? Do you think that same spirit could empower us to pray for healing, pray for the oppressed? Absolutely. Do you think that same spirit could enable us to be supernaturally hospitable in a world that likes to make my stuff, but we can openly share with others? Absolutely. Jesus has rescued you from the domain of darkness. He's redeemed you, he's saved you, he's washed you, and because of all of that saving work, we relate to God differently. We don't cower, we don't avoid. Jesus says we have a loving Father in heaven who is ready to talk, ready to interact, ready to give, ready to respond, ready to empower us for the kind of life he has called us into. And as apprentices to Jesus, we're called not only to follow Jesus in spirit, but we are called to continue his work on earth as it is in heaven. This means praying for healing, praying for the lost, praying for the poor, the oppressed, the marginalized, opening up our homes and our lives to those far from God, and in word and deed, proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom of heaven. And as you and I journey with Jesus, allowing him to shape our life, it's from that place of transformation that we offer a lived proclamation of the gospel. Your going comes from the overflow of your abiding with and submission to Jesus' renewing work in you. And this is what fulfills that mandate Jesus gives us in Matthew chapter 28 to go and make disciples of all nations, whether that be the neighbor across the road or someone across the continent. The mission is the same. You can step in to going with him, joining him in his work, doing what he did by listening and obediently following him, no matter what the cost. And so in terms of a next step, like what do we do with this today? I think my mind goes to like two things primarily. One is listening, and the second is obeying. So listening, out of that place of being with him and becoming like him, we can join him in his work. We can do the things he did, and he is doing through you and through me. But it starts actually with listening. Whether it's a short in the morning, God, I'm open, attentive, and available to you. What do you have for me today? A simple, was that 8-second prayer as you open your eyes in the morning. As you're heading into a really difficult conversation with a coworker, God, what would you have me do in this moment? As you're picking up the pieces from a fight with your spouse, as you're maybe hitting a wall with one of your kids, not any of these kids, of course, other kids. Whatever the thing is, as you enter into those hard moments, like we said last week, all of those hard moments have the potential to shape us and change us. As we enter those hard moments, it's just a stop and a moment of like, Jesus, what are you up to right now? As you're sick, or your spouse is sick. You guys know my sister is walking through breast cancer right now. And there have been lots of those moments. Jesus, what do you want me to do here? I live 400 miles away. I can't get up there that often. And when I'm up there, it just feels like we bring our chaos of kids with us. And I don't know if this is helpful or not. What do you want me to do here? So you're stepping into whatever those moments are for you. Start by listening. Because chances are, I mean, I would love if like our gut instinct was totally in line with Jesus every time, but many times our gut instinct is it needs a little tweaking. We say, Jesus, what are you up to here? What do you want me to do? How can I be a part of this? That's step one, listening. Knowing that we have a Father who loves to respond. Knowing that as we ask, seek, and knock, Jesus meets us in that place. But the second thing is obedience. It is no good listening if we're not actually going to listen and obey. Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and not do what I tell you? There are going to be many, many in the day who said, Lord, we prophesied in your name, we cast out demons in your name, and Jesus said, I never knew you. Okay, so we listen in the small kind of early morning moments, the moments before a hard thing, and as we just walk into any new situation, we're just listening, but also we have to obey. Jesus says, I want you to go chat with this person and just tell him God loves you. He sees you, he hears you, he loves you. Oh, I can't do that. That's too hard. That's going to be too awkward. Well, what's the point of listening? What's the point of actually asking Jesus what you should do if you're not going to do it? Oh, maybe I should. Jesus is like, I think you need to pay for this person's meal. I don't know. It looks like an expensive meal. It's more than what I got. I don't know if I want to do that. What's the point of listening if you're not going to join him in those things? We have maybe a moment here in the gathered worship, and he's like, I just really feel like I should be praying for Marilyn, maybe just some encouragement over her today. I don't know. That's kind of weird. Like, I haven't talked to Marilyn in like a week or two. I don't know what's going on in her life. That maybe she looks like she's chatting with her kids. I don't want to say anything to her. Just miss those opportunities and those moments. Because to do what Jesus did, we actually have to do what Jesus did. So we listen. He's given us his Spirit. And obey. To step in to obedience. And that's it. I really desperately don't want to overcomplicate this one. Because I feel like we can theologically mind trick our way out of actually doing what Jesus did. We can do all kinds of crazy Bible gymnastics to like, oh, it was all hyperbole. Oh, Jesus didn't actually really mean it. Or Jesus was God. I'm not God, so I can't do those things. Like, guys, Jesus really clearly said we're going to do the things that he said we need to do. And the two obstacles that we have is in a distracted, noisy world is listening. And in a culture that prioritizes my own personal comfort, obedience. Will we listen and will we obey? And I think as I was working on this for you guys, as I was reading through scripture, reading through a few books, writing down some notes, I think that is like my prayer for our church. As we step into this new season, that we'd be a church of listeners that would be far more concerned with the voice of God than the voice of that podcast. They'd be far more concerned with what the Spirit is saying than what maybe even feels like is logical. And that we would obey. And let's not like try to bite off more than we can chew. I don't want to see any of you guys on a corner soapboxing down here. Like, let's just start with like a listening prayer and like, God, what is one way I can step into your obedience to you today? There are like 1,000 ways that could be possible. Let's not shoot for the moon. Let's just start small. Jesus, what are you saying? And how can I step into greater obedience with you today? And this is my prayer for our church community. As we step into summertime, as we step into all sorts of opportunities, events, as we step into travel, time with friends, time with family, like what might it look like to have our summer shaped by listening and obedience? What if that was what we as a church were known for? Oh, they pray a lot and they just obey God a lot. Like, what if? My mind is rolling with all the like, what if, what could happen if that was something that actually marked our church? Listening and obedience. The two least sexy things I could have ended a sermon with. We're going to be people that listen to God and do what he says. That's about as far as that vision goes, guys. But what if? Like, what if we actually stepped into that? So much potential. So we're going to respond in some worship. It is a great, hey guys, worship is a great opportunity to practice listening and practice obeying. In the safest of safe environments, friends and church family who love you and will not be offended if you say, hey, I think I'd like to pray for you. Guys, if we can't do it in here, we can't do it out there. Safest of safe environment right here. It's an opportunity to listen. Prophecy is not for just like the special people. Encouragement's not just for the special people. It is for all of us, the church family. So we're going to do that. We're going to lean into some response today. We're going to lean into some worship and lean into some practice opportunities for listening and obedience. Jesus, we really humbly come before you. This audacious mandate of doing what you did can sound really grandiose. And we actually just pray for the strength to obey and the patience to listen. We recognize that as we listen, an answer doesn't always come in our timing. Sometimes we need to sit and be still for a while. And we know that the strength to obey, sometimes we need your strength just to override our own personal gratification matrix. We need your strength. The Spirit inside us who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in me. Spirit, help me listen, help me obey. Jesus, I pray that you'd give each one of us a vision for what our little church community could be like if we were a people of listening prayer and obedience. I'm thinking of all those people who are far from God, represented from the people in the room here, all the friends, the families, the coworkers, the neighbors. What if we started tomorrow with a listening prayer and we're ready to obey, even if it made us a little uncomfortable, even if it made us seem a little bit weird, even if it downgraded our cool factor a level? Like, what if? Jesus, give us vision for these simple practices of listening and obeying. And through that, Jesus, I pray for the fruit of a people doing what you did, joining you in your work here. Jesus, you have beautiful things in store for this church, for all the churches, for this city. You have beautiful things in store. And we pray for the strength that you supply to help us obey. And we pray for the patience, the peace, the grace, the patience to pause and to listen to you. And I pray, Jesus, as we step into these very simple practices, that you would meet us in those spaces. I'm fully confident that if we pause to listen, you don't actually leave us hanging, but you meet us here. And as we kind of take a leap of faith into some version of obedience, that you're there supplying strength, encouragement. Whether we're met with a positive or negative response is sort of irrelevant to our obedience. So Jesus, would you empower us for the life that you've called us to here in Ventura County? And as we worship and respond to you, we ask that you'd be speaking and moving and prompting us towards obedience, even this morning. We pray this in your name. Amen.